morning. Our scripture reading this morning is Psalms 1. This can be found on page 489 in the Old Testament portion of your pew Bibles. Reading from Psalm 1. Hear what the Spirit says to the church. Happy are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers. But their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law they meditate night, day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. In all that they do, they prosper. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the righteous, and the way of the wicked will perish. This is the word of the Lord.
A professor of philosophy tells about how he learned to play the piano. And what happened first was that his parents decided that they would have a little chart. And so every time he sat down to practice for half an hour, would check off the box, and then at the end of the week, all the boxes would be full. Did that work?
No.
No, it didn't. The next tactic they tried was, if you will practice for 30 minutes every day, we will give you $20 a week. Did that work?
No.
Then they tried another tactic. If you don't practice, we are going to do... You know how that goes. And did that work?
No.
No, that didn't work either. Then he got a new piano teacher. The new piano teacher at the first lesson said, "You go and sit over there." And the piano teacher sat down at the piano and played Moonlight Sonata, which David can play very well. And that boy said, "I want to play like that." He had been given a vision of what it could look like, and he wanted it. Well, I would suggest to you that Psalm 1 is meant to be like Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata for the people of God. It's meant to place before us this wonderful vision of what it can be like to live our lives rooted deep in the grace and the goodness and the kindness and mercy of the living God, and what that can grow. Happy are those who delight in the Lord. They are like trees planted beside streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. In all that they do, they prosper. Trees are symbols of beauty and steadfastness. And for me, they're part of who I am. Remember, I come from a milling family. We trees are in our blood. We love trees. But you know what it's like on a hot day to sit down in the shade of a great tree, to feel the shelter of it, and then to listen to the sound of the wind around you making the leaves dance, and all of these aspens we have here in the West that help to make that lovely sound that's so soothing. Like Psalm 1, Isaiah also portrays God's people as trees. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. Have you seen that glory? It's an amazing vision. Actually, this is the gift of the gospel, is that ordinary lives like ours can vibrate and be in tune to display the glory of God in all the everyday places where we live and work, in the nitty-gritty of life. That's glory. Well, I told you that trees were in my background. And there's actually a row of oak trees on the farm that belonged to my grandparents in eastern Nova Scotia. And this slide shows one of them, the one that's out in the pasture. And it was planted by my great-great-grandfather Hugh when he settled there in the 19th century. See how big the trunk is up close? Takes four people to encircle this oak tree. And through the centuries, and through disease and famine and flood and storm, this oak tree has kind of become, for our family, a symbol of steadfastness and goodness. It means a lot to us to stand under that tree and to look at the river valley that spreads out before you from that tree. As kids, we would play under it in that pasture. And, you know, my brother has a desk that was built from the lumber that was sawed from one limb from that tree. So I want you to take that tree, and I want you to think of what the vision of steadfastness and God's glory looks like in you. What does it look like in a human life? Okay, we've seen God's glory and the beauty that's around us. Now, what does that glory look like in a human being? What does that vision look like in flesh and blood? Is it a life of ease? You know, where everything kind of goes like this, from beginning to end. Is that the way your life has gone? No. Maybe a little of this, and then some of this, and then down here for a while, and then maybe back up here. But what I've seen in my almost 30 years of ministry now, among sainted people of the church that I've had the privilege to walk beside, is that when life may take these dips and hollows and dark places, that there's a strength that deep roots can draw on that bring a steadfastness, a beauty, a glory, a peace that passes understanding. Have you seen that? Have you seen that in flesh and blood? That's the vision of Psalm 1. And on Father's Day, I was thinking of how I got to see that vision in my father. This is us together, the two of us, just a few years ago. My hair color may not be quite the same anymore. But my dad filled our house with love and joy. He loved to tell stories all the time and loved to keep us laughing and loved to retell stories too. Always joy. He worked long hours. Sometimes that could be frustrating. You know, when I was left at the end of the driveway because someone came to get lumber, and now I was left alone. But Sundays were always our day. On Sunday, he was ours. On Sunday morning, singing in our church's choir brought him pure delight. He loved to sing. And on Sunday afternoon, there was always time. Time. So time to visit with family, or time just to take a walk in the woods together, to be able to think of that bird, or this kind of tree, or these kinds of rocks, and just enjoy. One of the things that has stayed with me most powerfully from his example is how everyday life can be a ministry of grace. I got to travel with him in the truck when he would deliver a load of wood, and you might think, just a business transaction. No chance. No, every interaction is an opportunity to see people, to listen to people, even to have tea with them if they invite you in. I got to see in the vision of his life how serving the community can be a conduit of God's love. And you know, his life didn't always just go like this. There was this summer that he and his four brothers lost their living when a flood came through and took away the mill. And then there was also when he was diagnosed with cancer, suffered, and died when I was 21. And what I saw in all of that was this. I saw these deep roots that went down, that tapped in to a peace that passes understanding, and a steadfastness that just stays and stays, and that delights in the goodness of the Lord. And that's what Psalm 1 longs for each of us, is to be able to delight in that goodness. For thousands of years, the book of Psalms has had a central place in the life of God's people, both as a guide for personal devotion and for Sunday morning worship. Probably most of the churches of the world read from this book every Sunday. For 300 years, Presbyterians sang nothing but the Psalms, right? The Psalter is the longest book of the Bible, and as Martin Luther called it, it's the little Bible, because it contains, as he says, beautifully and briefly everything that's in the entire Bible condensed in this one book. You can learn what God is like and how God deals with human beings and the world. You can hear about the human predicament, the conduct of life, and how it affects the outcome. You can be taught the language of trust and prayer and praise. And as James May says, through this book, God will give you strength in adversity, gratitude in success, patience in guilt, and thanksgiving in forgiveness. Today, we begin a whole summer of Psalms together as a congregation. And so during the coming weeks, we are going to survey the many types of Psalms that are found throughout this book, from praise and trust to penitence and lament. You know, the good, the bad, and the ugly will all be included in our series this summer. And today we begin with Psalm 1. And one thing I am going to challenge myself to do, and I'm just going to throw this in now, it's not in the script if you're reading that, but I would like all of us to think about praying the Psalms this summer. Now, We will go through a number that will be spread throughout the whole book, but we can fill in those days. And I would challenge you to think about praying through the Psalms during this summer season and see if you can make it through the 150 of them. As you know, the order of anything in the Bible is not haphazard. And the Psalms, well, no, it's intentional that Psalm 1 is Psalm 1. It's the introduction. And it's the book that begins with a beatitude or a blessing. Not a prayer, not a hymn, but really a statement about human existence. The way that life is lived is decisive about how it's going to turn out. The psalm is here to invite us to read and to use this entire book as a guide to a blessed life. This is the way, it's saying. Come, this is the way at the crossroads. Are you looking for a blessed life? Come this way. Come this way. So Psalm 1 introduces the book of Psalms as scripture. Now we get used to sometimes using it as just poetry or prayer. Psalm 1 says, this is scripture. Don't forget. It is an instruction to be studied, to be listened to, and to absorb. And I would suggest to you that absorbing the Psalms creates a capacity in us. A good friend of mine, she grew up in Calgary. And in her home, they read through the Proverbs over and over and over again at their lunchtime table. And over time, when you do that, it builds a kind of capacity in you. And it's the same with the Psalms. Over time, it sinks in and it helps to shape our outlook, our actions, the very anatomy of our soul. So here's Psalm 1 placing us at this crossroads and saying, come this way, come this way. Remember Robert Frost's well-known poem, The Road Not Taken. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. Psalm 1 says, this is the road that makes the difference. Come this way. Take this road. And you will find blessing. Doesn't mean it's always going to be an easy road. But you will find blessing. Psalm 1 is about life direction. And it's about life outcomes. Psalm 1 says that we can find this road less traveled in the law of the Lord. And by delighting in that, by meditating on it, by letting it sink in and help to form and shape us. Now, law here in the New Revised Standard, the translation, we have to be careful that we don't hear that as rules. You know, it's a much bigger word than that that is in this Hebrew word. The Hebrew word Torah, instruction. The instruction of God. Think about how that professor of philosophy opened himself to the instruction of that piano teacher that changed the course of his music story. That's what the Lord can do for us when we choose that way. Psalm 1 is asking us the question, so what is directing your life? Is it ambition? Is it culture? Is it material goods? Is it pleasing other people? Is it what I want? What's directing your life? Or is it God? The answer to the question, Psalm 1 says, is absolutely pivotal, and it makes a difference where the destination is going to be. Because, as the psalm is not afraid to tell us, one road leads to life and one road leads to death. Each way has a distinct destination. And so the psalm is asking us today, in which direction are your feet set? Which way? So some people look at Psalm 1 and think that it has a pretty simplistic, formulaic approach to life. So if you delight in the Lord, everything's going to be great. You're going to be like this luxuriant tree, and it's always going to be good, right? And then if you take the other road, well, game over there. And people say, that's not really how life goes, is it? No. Remember, this is at the beginning of the book. How do we start when we're children? Sometimes things just need to be straightforward and simple at the beginning. Because you know in this book, there's actually going to be some psalms you're not going to like. And it's going to seem like there's some mean people writing some of these psalms along the way. Yeah, this book is bigger than a simplistic orientation towards life. I don't see the outcome of delight in the Lord or this life of blessedness as getting everything you want, sort of the big house, the great career, and all of those things. But in this 30 years of ministry that I've had, what I see as the outcome of the life of blessedness is that kind of deep-rootedness that brings with it, in the midst of a life that goes like this, this. The peace that passes understanding, the confidence in the sovereign good of God, no matter what. God can work through the worst down. And some people say that we learn the most through those times. God doesn't waste any of that. But Psalm 1 reminds us that we're held in the faithful hands of a God of love who through this can bring this. So there's no middle ground here. If you're looking for the gray in Psalm 1, you are not going to find it, because it's either this way or this way. And maybe it's important for us to know that there is always a time for decision. Right? There are some traditions in the church that you will be faced with that decision every Sunday. Which way is it going to be for you? But in Psalm 1, the connection between devotion and destiny is non-negotiable. Psalm 1 does not allow for ambiguity. Psalm 1 has a confidence that is the only thinkable response to our world, that delight in the Lord is the way. Now, some people might think that you only get to go through a crossroads once in life, but that doesn't seem to be the way that God works. And the way that God's love works in our life as well. Because even when we start to stray, it's amazing how those forces end up keeping us back. And there we are at another crossroads again with another chance, with another possibility for grace. I'd like us to look at the crossroads that is found in this clip from Les Misérables. Jean Valjean has just gotten out of prison. He has nowhere to go but the bishop's house. And the bishop welcomes him in. But Jean Valjean steals the silverware and knocks down the bishop and escapes. But when the police catch him the next day and bring him back to the bishop, here's what happens. Think of the crossroads that's been placed before Jean Valjean.
Stay there!
Monseigneur, we have your silver. We caught this man red-handed.
You had the nerve to say you gave him this.
That is right. But my friend, you left so early. Surely something slipped your mind.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
You forgot. I gave these also.
You left in such a hurry.
Would you
that
leave
you
the best
these pieces
behind?
Take them too.
Monsieur, listen. This man has spoken true. I commend you for your duty. Now God's blessing go with you. But remember this, my brother. See in this some higher plan. You must use this precious silver to become an honest man.